one of the most important investigations the program has mounted. Dramatic new evidence on the killing of policewoman Yvonne Fletcher in London's St. James's Square. Tonight, how the official version of the events behind her murder cannot be true. How she cannot have been shot from the Libyan embassy. But if not, then how? In a major two-part investigation, dispatches reporter Joe Laban pieces together the full sinister truth behind her death. He will meet the man who knows just why she was killed, and the man who brought the gun into this country. And he will ask exactly who was in the know. That's Dispatches, on the disturbing evidence we must confront in Murder in St. James's.
St. James's Square, a quiet haven in London's bustling West End. Ignored by office workers on their lunch breaks, a grieving mother visits a little-known memorial, a cherry blossom planted after her daughter, policewoman Yvonne Fletcher, was gunned down outside the Libyan embassy 13 years ago. So far, no one has been charged with her murder, even though it was committed in front of scores of witnesses and two television crews.
Until the whole situation is cleared up, it's not only hurtful to us, but it's hurtful to all the policemen and that who were there at the time, them not knowing what really happened.
So you think it's right that people keep looking into this?
I think it is, until they found out the truth of the situation.
April the 17th, 1984, began with a common sight for Londoners, demonstrators protesting outside the embassy of a hated regime. The focus of their anger, Libya's Colonel Gaddafi, a tyrant who hanged dissenters at home and hunted them down overseas. For the police, it was just part of the daily grind. For the public, a colourful diversion. One constable caught everyone's attention, Yvonne Fletcher, then the shortest police officer in Britain. She seemed relaxed and cheerful.
I'm sure that she was entering into the spirit. She was smiling, laughing. There wasn't any animosity anywhere at that time.
I remember when we came out from the bus, the policewoman was greeting us. It was a beautiful day, a sunny day. And we came down and the policewoman was saying good morning to us and she was smiling.
Soon after the anti-Gaddafi demonstrators arrived, Gaddafi supporters came out of the embassy to shout back at them.
Then it got a bit nasty. Everyone was yelling and screaming and being quite horrid. And at that time I noticed that the window on the second floor was being opened by some swarthy Egyptian-type-looking man. Didn't think anything more of it.
No one else realised the significance of the embassy's open windows, least of all the police officers standing directly beneath.
But about 10 minutes after that, some shots were fired.
Some bullets flew over the heads of the demonstrators, hitting an office block across the square.
So the bullets went like this, really, because the first bullet was there, the second was there, and there. So they went diagonally.
Bang, bang, bang.
Yes, that's right. I suppose so, yeah. It was morning, and I was in my office, which was on the second floor of up there, yes. And suddenly, a bullet came through the double glazed window, hit a column which was opposite me, and then ricocheted and hit me on the head.
Where did it hit you?
There.
Tragically, there was no lucky escape for Yvonne Fletcher, standing on the other side of the square.
For me, it was like fireworks. I was taking photographs of the incident. And I looked in the front of me, and I saw the policewoman was coming down very, very slowly.
At the time, it seemed clear what had happened. A camera crew filming the demonstration caught what sounded like the last shot of a burst of automatic gunfire. Yvonne Fletcher was hit, an incident which sent shockwaves round the world. Her colleagues got her to a side street, along with 11 anti-Gaddafi demonstrators, also injured in the hail of bullets. She was taken by ambulance to Westminster Hospital, but died soon after. The bullet which hit her had caused massive damage. Doctors could do nothing to stop the internal bleeding. After a standoff of 10 days, the Libyans were allowed to leave, five at a time. Others had already fled through a back exit. To the dismay of the police, no action would be taken against any of them. Instead, the remaining 22 diplomats and eight others were escorted to Heathrow Airport. 3 weeks later, the jury at the inquest delivered their verdict. Yvonne Fletcher was unlawfully killed by a bullet fired from the first floor of the Libyan embassy. That then is the received wisdom, but members of the intelligence world began to tell us privately that all was not as it seemed. Though this was an apparently routine demonstration, the security services were there in force. None will speak out in public, but their concerns have been passed to former colleagues. One man still in close touch is former member of British Army Intelligence, Colin Wallace.
There's a general feeling of unease that the full truth has never been discovered, and it could be that this was simply a matter of people covering up after the event, maybe to hide the fact that something went wrong. But I think the great difficulty we have is that when something goes dreadfully wrong in the intelligence community, because it is such a closed world, it is virtually impossible for any organization to get at the truth at a later date.
To try to get at the truth, we built a computer model to reconstruct the events of April the 17th, 1984. We reassessed the evidence collected by the police and their forensic experts. We went back to the evidence given before this court at the inquest into Yvonne Fletcher's death. The case was wrapped up quickly by the coroner, Paul Knapman, but alarming inconsistencies were not addressed. We wanted to compare what the inquest heard with the original post-mortem report, but despite a request from Yvonne Fletcher's mother, Dr. Knapman refused to release it. Professor Bernard Knight did the crucial forensic work on the victims of Fred and Rosemary West. With 40 years' experience, he's one of Britain's leading pathologists.
Well, the coroner's act and the coroner's rules say that interested parties are entitled to a copy of the post-mortem report on application to the coroner and payment of a fee.
So the mother of a victim would class, presumably, as an interested party?
I'd thought so.
We wrote again to the coroner, reminding him of his obligations. He relented and released the post-mortem report. This was highly revealing. It showed the pathologist, Dr. Ian West, had changed drastically his analysis of what he thought had happened. There were big differences between what he wrote in the post-mortem report and what he said subsequently at the inquest. We took these findings to an expert in gunshot wounds, the former chief consultant surgeon to the British Army in Northern Ireland.
The actual track of the bullet gives the actual body story of what went on. If I can explain. The pathologist's first report found this angle of entry into the back of the deceased at 60 to 70 degrees.
To quote Dr. West's post-mortem report,
the angle of the bullet wound track indicates that she was shot in the back by a person who was situated at a considerably higher level. The track would indicate that she had been shot from the upper floors of an adjacent building.
But the police experts found no evidence of bullets fired from anywhere other than the first floor of the embassy. The angle from the first floor is just 15 degrees. One of the demonstrators had a stomach wound where the bullet had indeed entered at 15 degrees. But that doesn't square with the wounds to Yvonne Fletcher.
The bullet had entered the chest wall, gone down into the liver at an angle measured as 60 to 70 degrees. That really means that it was fired by someone, as he said in his first report, from the top of a high building. You're talking six, seven, eight floors, depending on how far away from the building the subject is standing. But what happened in this case was that, unfortunately, an attempt was subsequently made to marry the post-mortem findings to the evidential findings reflecting the 15 degrees.
So once the police have said it's probably the first floor of the Libyan embassy, that would be a 15 degree angle, you're sort of working backwards as the pathologist, is that what you're saying?
Well, there is a tendency, I mean, obviously there's this pressure on any pathologist to try and match the evidence.
At the inquest, Dr. West said she must have been turning when she was shot. This, he claimed, would reduce the angle of the bullet wound from 60 degrees to 15. Turning, together with the natural curve of her back, would make it
entirely consistent with a shot fired from the first floor window.
Now, the pathologist placed a lot of emphasis on the fact that Yvonne Fletcher must have been turning when she was shot, and that this would have affected the angle.
I'm not sure that I see how turning affects it. Leaning backwards or leaning forwards would affect it, but turning, to me, means that the horizontal parts of the body stay at the same level, and the body turns on its axis.
But he set a great deal of store by this, the pathologist, Dr. Ian West. He suggested that in order to put the gunman in the first floor embassy window, she had to be turning in that direction, from left to right.
Yeah, well, I can't understand that. I can't see how it's relevant.
You can't match an angle of 60 degrees or so to a 15 degree angle. Now, an attempt was made, and that attempt, in my opinion, was quite facile. If Yvonne Fletcher, PC Fletcher, had been turning, that the turning, the mechanism of turning, would somehow reduce the incipient angle to the body. And that's rubbish, because, as you can see, you can turn, you'd have to actually do a Fosbury flop in order to get that angle down to any great degree. And that's impossible to even conceive.
This graphic reconstruction shows just how far back Yvonne Fletcher would have had to lean to get the angle down to 15 degrees. It's an unlikely posture, impossible to achieve without falling over. Bending forwards would have left different internal injuries.
This is a nonsense. When you turn, you normally turn this way. Your chest hardly moves. If it does move at the outer part, the injuries sustained at this part and this angle certainly don't. Towards the core, they don't alter at all. The fact is that if you turn, the lumbar spine still remains in roughly the same area. It's a nonsense.
Well, what on earth was he talking about?
He'd have to explain that. I don't know what he's talking about. That evidence, I don't consider valid. At all.
We asked Dr. West to explain his conclusions. First, he cancelled two appointments. Then he declined an interview and refused to even meet us. The second thing that caught Hugh Thomas's attention was the speed of the bullet which killed WPC Fletcher. When it hit her, it was running out of energy.
In this particular instance, the gunshot came through the chest, smashed through the liver, and made a tremendous, considerable amount of damage as it went through, hit the inferior vena cava, which is a large vessel going down in this region here, got reflected off the surface of one of the lumbar vertebrae and went sideways and backwards at an angle through the rest of the liver and the pancreas, ending up by coming out of the chest wall and going around the elbow, which is held to the side, and plopping out, falling into the cloth. Literally fell out. It was at terminal velocity.
So that means it was slowing down at the
point. It had almost slowed down. Well, it did actually stop. It had actually caused these wounds in its terminal path. It was tumbling. The effect on the liver means it was tumbling even before it actually hit the lumbar spine itself.
A tumbling bullet, like the one that killed Yvonne Fletcher, is usually at the end of the range of the weapon which fired it. For a Sterling submachine gun, the weapon the police thought was fired from the embassy, the range is more than the width of St. James's Square. But Yvonne Fletcher was standing just 30 yards away. Lieutenant Colonel George Styles, 26 years in the British Army, was one of its leading weapons experts.
I don't think a submachine gun killed the police lady.
Why not?
Because the bullet was going comparatively slowly, and I think from a submachine gun it would have gone that extra bit faster than the wounds that you've described?
Sterling is a submachine gun, and at 30 yards you'd expect the bullet to go almost straight through anybody standing in front of it.
From the description of the wounds, I think if it was a submachine gun, there would have been a little bit more penetration. The bullet wouldn't have tumbled about so much, it would have gone a bit straighter.
The end of the range of a submachine gun certainly isn't 30 yards. And any pathologist faced with this would have raised eyebrows instantly at such a concept.
Surprisingly, this obvious point was not raised at the inquest, either by the pathologist or the police ballistics experts. We took Hugh Thomas to the square. He was struck by the fact that number 5 is one of the smaller buildings.
Do you think Yvonne Fletcher was shot from number 5, from the building behind you?
I would think it's almost impossible that she was shot from number 5, because there's no floor in the building which would give an angle of 60 to 70 degrees or anything close to it.
Now, this is an extraordinary suggestion that you are making. I want you to be quite clear. You do not believe Yvonne Fletcher was shot from that embassy building behind you?
For two reasons. The terminal velocity of 30 yards, which is the distance from me to the building, would be an extraordinary event for a submachine gun bullet. And secondly, the angle of 60 to 70 degrees of entry into the body would be totally inconsistent with an angle of 15 degrees or so coming from that building. There may well have been shots fired from number 5, but you can't say that the bullet that entered her body came from that angle. It's impossible to have that occur.
Barry Howson, one-time choir boy. Today he plays the organ each week at his local church in Sussex. But in the early 80s he was a major arms dealer, selling weapons to Libya. He stayed close to Gaddafi and others in the Libyan regime. At the time of the shooting he was a frequent visitor to the embassy in St James's Square.
They were sold, Sterling, some machine guns. I saw those. I saw a couple of East German pistols lying around, but they were pretty careful with that stuff. It was locked in a sort of cabinet in the main first floor reception.
So just to be quite clear, you had bigger fish to fry. You were doing bigger arms deals
direct
with
Libya.
Back
yes,
Tripoli.
That's right. Yes. Yes.
And you weren't selling handguns, for example, to the embassy?
No, no.
But other people were?
Oh, yes, yes.
Would the authorities, the British authorities, have known about this?
Well, of course they would.
The Libyans were housed in considerable elegance in their London embassy. Guests at the ambassador's receptions might not have known of the cache of guns and ammunition, but the occupants were waging a campaign of terror in Britain. A month before the shooting, the police anti-terrorist branch warned Libyan exiles to be alert. Two bomb attacks followed in London and Manchester. Questions were asked in Parliament, yet the embassy stayed open.
The Libyan People's Bureau in London would have been a major target for both British and American intelligence operations. This would have involved electronic surveillance, intercepting telephone messages, telex messages, radio messages, the use of microphones to pick up any communication from windows, etc., the planting of microphones and bugs within the building where that's possible, photographing all visitors to the building. The building would have been under surveillance by intelligence officers in adjoining buildings or from vehicles.
Phone calls in and out of the embassy on the ordinary landline. The powers that be in this country knew about it before you did, you know.
So if you were having dealings over the phone with the Libyan embassy,
yes,
they would know about
yes.
it? What, they would come and talk to you about it?
Yes, I've had a couple of occasions when I've been approached and told, you know, would I mind not going ahead with this particular operation.
Barry Howson's suspicions were well-founded. In the weeks before the shooting, the security services stepped up their surveillance. They established an observation post to monitor the Libyans on one of the upper floors of number 3.
They were just common tire and smart people. I would say in the region between 25 to 40. So, I mean, this came about spread over 4 or 5 weeks. The explanation I was given was that there was a lot of pilfering going on in the square, and they wanted to try and view different parts of the square from that angle.
But you don't really buy that explanation. You think they were more interested
in
Libyans?
Not now. I did at the time.
By April 1984, the Libyan embassy was breaking up into factions, hardline revolutionaries, career diplomats, and others whose loyalty to Gaddafi was suspect. Two of the career diplomats warned the British authorities that trouble was brewing. They tried desperately to get the demonstration stopped, without success.
Everybody knew this was a powder keg. This was waiting to blow up.
But they'd had demonstrations outside before, sure.
Half a dozen people with a couple of white flags.
This was felt to be different?
Yes, definitely. Very, very different.
The paranoia inside the embassy was heightened because the demonstrators weren't just students. The organisers, the National Front for the Salvation of Libya, were financed in part by the CIA. A month after the demonstration, they staged an unsuccessful military coup against Gaddafi. They'd long since infiltrated the embassy and passed on what they knew to the British authorities.
We were very successful in that regard. I mean, it became one time that at least we have one person in the major embassies, Libyan embassies abroad.
Including London?
Sometimes more.
Including London?
Including London. And we have our people in very close circles to Gaddafi himself.
On the day of the demonstration, the police received two separate warnings that there might be a shooting incident. At around 7:30 a.m., the Libyans warned contractors setting out crowd control barriers that they had guns inside and there would be shooting. The police were told this over half an hour before the demonstrators even arrived. But they didn't take the threat seriously. They also ignored the suspicions of a security guard at number 4, who saw packages taken into the embassy which he thought might contain weapons. But these were not the only warnings. We have spoken to members of the intelligence services who tell us that the electronic surveillance had worked. They say MI5 knew the day before that shooting was on the cards.
Members of the intelligence community believe that the security service did receive information from a reliable source and almost certainly from another intelligence agency.
So let's be clear about this. We're talking about MI5 here. We're talking about another intelligence agency. Who is this?
Almost certainly it was an American agency, whether it was the CIA or one of the other organizations, we don't know, but almost certainly another agency, possibly American, provided information to the security service to the effect that firearms were likely to be used in an incident involving the Libyan People's Bureau.
To piece together just what the authorities knew, dispatches have spoken over many months to well-placed sources in Western intelligence and key Libyan defectors about the events in the square. We've confirmed that the British and American security services were in regular contact with informants inside the embassy. By this time, they could easily decode telecommunications to and from the building. The day before the demonstration, the embassy cabled Libya with three options: do nothing, seize some of the dissidents, or shoot them. This crucial information, which would have saved Yvonne Fletcher's life, was intercepted, but it only got as far as British intelligence. It never reached those in the firing line.
We're talking 1984, the police were very definitely outside the loop because they weren't seen as part of the intelligence picture, simply hadn't been part of the tradition.
In Britain, government and the security services meet in Whitehall at the hugely powerful and top secret Joint Intelligence Committee. Few know its workings intimately. One who does is the former civil servant assigned to it shortly after the shooting.
The police aren't part of the Whitehall village culture. They're not part of the picture. From my own knowledge, you're talking about the stuff we're talking about here, which is intelligence and politics and international politics at that, then the police would certainly have been out of the loop. The tradition was MI6 and intelligence generally, particularly 6, and senior civil service were of a particular class, if you want.
Social class?
Yeah, public school, Oxbridge, etc. And Mr. Plod was somewhat different.
The police received quite specific warnings on the day of the embassy shooting that an incident involving firearms might be taking place, but they didn't take it seriously.
Well, it would make sense, you know, when you have these intercepts coming in and so on at the Cabinet Office, there are then subcommittee meetings to consider the different bits of information that are coming in. Now, the practice is to get all the different civil servants in, and indeed somebody from MI5 or 6 or GCHQ would also be present at some of those meetings to consider the significance or otherwise of the information received. It would make sense sometimes to have the police there, but I don't ever remember the police as such being present at any of those subcommittee meetings.
If there was a system for sharing information with the police, they might have taken the warning seriously.
Undoubtedly.
Amazingly, the police were excluded from the Whitehall village even after one of their officers was shot. Cobra, the special cabinet office committee to deal with emergencies, met every morning during the crisis, but the police weren't invited until the third day. Sir Kenneth Newman, then commissioner of the Metropolitan Police, arrived first, but it was too late. The key decisions had already been made. So what exactly had happened inside the intelligence community? Selected journalists were told in unofficial briefings at the time that as messages flew between London and Libya, the crucial intercept got lost somehow in the bureaucratic maze. A seductive theory, but dismissed by insiders.
I think it's unbelievable that an intercept of such importance dealing with a prime target would have been put aside casually or overlooked. The intelligence services, despite the way that sometimes they're projected, are very efficient organizations. And an electronic intercept would have passed through a number of different bodies within a very short period of being received.
If there is a need to do something before morning, then it will be done. Some of the people I worked with were on bleeps. They'd be working up. Cars would be sent to fetch them in. Emergency meetings would be had. All could happen in the middle of the night if it was necessary. Even if you had doubts, then you would wake somebody more senior up so they would carry the can, not you.
It was inconceivable that you could have a succession of cock-ups in a short period of time that would mean a key piece of information would be totally overlooked. I just don't accept that.
The ambassador's office in the Libyan embassy. Libya and Libyan apologists have always claimed there was no shooting at all from here. Our research has found this to be a fantasy. But some of the police evidence is also fanciful. The police believe two Sterling submachine guns were fired from this, the first floor. They found traces of gunfire on the curtains and the sill of this very window. Witnesses disagreed over which window the firing came from, but significantly, no one saw two gunmen. When the forensic experts searched the building, they found no traces of guns fired from any of the higher floors.
The police experts at the time thought there might have been two guns.
Well, like I say, I only heard the one. It sounded the same gun that was firing all the shots.
The police forensic experts told the inquest they were virtually certain that two Sterlings were used, one firing 9 bullets, the other firing 3. They might have revised this opinion if they'd listened to all the available audio evidence. On the day of the shooting, two professional film crews were in the square. The cameraman who filmed this footage missed the shooting completely. The other one switched on late and caught just a single shot.
How did it sound to you?
I would say it sounded like a crackling.
Like a firecracker?
No, it was like, repeat if you know what I mean. Maybe 6 to 12 shots.
The police did have a far better piece of audio evidence, but it was never presented at the inquest. It was recorded on a home video camera hired by a student demonstrator. The police have refused to let us have a copy, though it was given to a BBC programme shown a year after the shooting. We took all the recordings made on the day to a leading audio analyst.
There is something at this point.
He's used as an expert witness in court cases. First off, he analysed the student tape.
Now that excerpt you've just played there is from the Libyan tape, which wasn't admitted as evidence at the inquest. Does that surprise you? The police thought it wasn't very helpful, it wasn't very conclusive.
Well, I'm surprised that it's not helpful because it shows that there's an automatic weapon involved. How many shots we can see if we slow it down.
You can break it down on those peaks.
Yeah, we can break it down. So if we play it slower, which will be like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
What's the gap between them?
It's about a tenth of a second.
So a tenth between each?
Yeah.
Let's just pay those 11 bullets all together.
Okay.
Now, does that sound like one gun to you or two guns?
That sounds like one gun.
You've not much doubt about that?
I've not much doubt about that.
So the student tape captures only 11 bullets, but the police recovered 12. The 12th bullet was discovered hours after the event in the ambulance which took Yvonne Fletcher and other gunshot victims to hospital. The police assumed this was the bullet which killed her, but they couldn't be sure. However, there is a way to account for all 12 bullets using the audio evidence available. The key here is the cameraman who switched on just in time to catch a single shot. It's possible that he caught something other than the 11th bullet in the burst from the Stirling. What he recorded may be something quite separate, a 12th bullet, clearly audible, fired from a second weapon.
We've got 11 bullets from the automatic weapon, and we seem to have the 12th. There is something at this point. Now, whether that sounds like a shot, a single shot, that is. So two guns, probably a pistol, but a semi-automatic and a pistol.
Now that is a single shot that you've isolated there, but there seems to be a pause beforehand. How long is that?
There's a pause, there's a cut here. And between that cut and the gunfire is just over 2 seconds, about 2.5 seconds.
So the cameraman is turning over for 2.5 seconds before he picks up that loud bang.
Yes, and the background, there's a car engine running. And and you can hear the car engine running behind that gunshot, so there is no cut at the point of the gunshot.
So this is definitely all of a piece, this is just as it was recorded.
It appears to be all of one piece, yep. We hear the chanting, which goes up to... Now, the chanting goes up to here, and then there is a... And then it changes. So, on the video, there is a cut, and therefore the audio changes. Now, at that point, you can hear the sound of a car or a van or someone's engine, and that goes on for 2 seconds prior to the bang. And then it continues, and the car engine appears to continue through that. And then everybody goes into confusion.
So even allowing for the fact that they're recorded on different sources, your analysis suggests that that's something different, sort of weapon.
Yes.
Why do you say that?
I say that because if you take the original sound of the single bullet, it's much louder. And it just seems more dense, it sounds more dense, whereas the the machine gun is, you know, rat-a-tat-tat, and isn't as loud. And
so this is a denser, louder sound.
It's a denser, louder sound, yes.
Now, given that we've got a two-second gap here, and the gaps between the bullets, the rat-a-tat-tat of the automatic weapon on the student tape are a tenth of a second, can these two be related?
No, they're not related at all. No, no. This is a separate shot entirely.
So what does that tell you? Does it suggest that there is another weapon involved here?
Suggests that there's another weapon. It suggests that there is either a handgun or something, another gun.
Firing a single shot.
This all suggests that whoever fired the bullet which killed WPC Fletcher was able to use the submachine gun fire from the embassy as cover. In the confusion, no one spotted the fatal 12th bullet fired from the top of a building nearby.
Just indicate to me where you think the bullet that killed her could have come from.
If I turn to my right to look behind me like this, it could well have come from the balcony on or from the roof or one of the higher floors of number 3. If, however, I'm standing like this, facing this way, then it could well have come from the building number 8. All we can say is she was shot at 60 to 70 degrees, and both buildings would give a possibility that that could occur.
But number 5, you don't even bring that into your equation?
It couldn't. The one bullet that caused the fatal injury certainly came from the higher building.
Not the embassy?
No.
Way above the square, there's cover for a sniper and possible escape routes. These rooftops, inaccessible from the embassy, were never searched by forensic experts. They can't be ruled out, but the risk of being seen makes an upper floor a safer choice for an assassin. We've spoken to occupants of number 8. In 1984, an American oil company had the top 2 floors, but staff saw nothing suspicious. Across the square at number 3, the top 2 floors were fully occupied by a British company, Distillers. Not so the 6th floor. This empty office space had some very unofficial tenants. The British security services had used it for weeks to watch the Libyans. But on the day of the demonstration, the pattern suddenly changed.
Were they in the building on the day, on April the 17th, 1984?
No, definitely not.
So that floor number 6 was just vacant? It was just
that
empty.
Floor had been vacant still.
If the killer did fire from number 3, there was a quick and easy escape route. With all eyes focused on the square, he could have been down these back stairs and into a quiet side street in under a minute. But who was he, and who set him up to do it? The trail of Yvonne Fletcher's killer was to take us far from St. James's Square, to a world where sex, drugs and guns are the currency of daily business. In one of Europe's crime capitals, we found ruthless men who know well the name of Yvonne Fletcher. What's more, they know exactly how and why she died. Next week, dispatches will unmask them and lay bare their guilty secret.
That's next Thursday on 4 at the same time, 9 o'clock.